friends, and welcome once again on Call to Serve. Call to Serve is a program that is dedicated to priests who are allowed to give their vocation testimonies. These are real-life stories of how to hear God's call, how to recognize it, and how we can listen to it if we are open to it. Today we have with us Father Luke Rodericks. Father Luke has been a Jesuit priest for the last 22 years. He was a professor at a B.Ed. college. Later, for 7 years, he was in lay formation in Rome. Currently, Father is serving as the assistant Jesuit provincial of Mumbai. Welcome to the program, Father. Before we can go to your call, can I have a little background? Can you share a little background of yours, what you did before you became a Jesuit priest?
Yes, my family background, a little bit on that. I was born into a devout Catholic family from Bandra.
Yes.
So I lived all my life in Bandra before joining the Jesuits. I'm the second of three brothers. Okay. In one sense, we are a little unusual, if you may say, the family, because we are just three boys,
right,
and all three of us are priests.
Oh, very
so
blessed family.
I have my elder brother who's a priest now working at Parel, at the Minor Seminary, an animator, spiritual animator, the Minor Seminary at Parel in Mumbai. Myself, I'm a Jesuit here.
Yeah.
And my younger brother is an auxiliary bishop. He's Bishop John Rodericks of Bombay Archdiocese.
Right.
So, well, that's the three of us. So we're just three, and all three are priests. I don't have my parents. My father died years ago, over 40 years ago. And mommy died maybe about 15 years back.
Oh.
But they were really the ones influential in our lives.
Father, can you share with us what got you to, into this vocation? What was it that actually got you here?
Okay. I've just said a little about my family, and I must continue answering your question, taking off from there. I think it's really a lot to do with the family atmosphere.
Right.
And that atmosphere of devotion and piety which was there in the family. And when I say piety, it didn't just mean a kind of, sculptured piety, but which was really love in action. I saw it in our family, in the way in which my parents would relate with others around. There was that sense of honoring the divine in people and
yes,
in situations.
Yes.
Maybe it wasn't so specific at that time, vocalized, but it
right.
was what we perhaps, the three of us brothers, picked up, particularly from our parents, but also then from the extended family. We had our grandmother at home, aunts, other people staying at home, and then the neighborhood also. It was a kind of a Catholic neighborhood in which we grew up, a place
yes.
where there was the prime importance given to God.
Right.
And where a vocation to the priesthood, to religious life, was something taken as a great call, something
okay.
worthwhile, something to be pursued. And so I grew up in that atmosphere. If I may say also, another part of my vocation would have been the Jesuit priests I encountered in school and in the parish.
Right.
I come from St. Peter's Parish,
yes.
St. Stanislaus School in Bandra. And I was influenced by the Jesuits there, when we saw them at Mass, but more specific, not just in their religious duties, but in the way in which they interacted with us, in altar boys, in the summer school, at camps, and things like that. There were so many priests who left a mark on my heart, on my soul. And I enjoyed their company, but I found something wonderful in these men. And there was always that sense of, can I be like them?
Them, right.
But finally, if we have to talk about vocation, what inspires, yes, there's the family background, which plays an important role. There are inspirational figures, like
right.
the priests in the parish and in the school, who influenced me a lot. But behind all of that is also a personal call. And it took me a while to understand that growing restlessness within myself, a sense of wanting something more than what I could see and put my hands on to. So, you know, while these other factors are the nurturing factors, there has to be that call, that personal choice of God telling me He wants me to be in this way of life,
okay.
following Him and serving Him in this way of life. And obviously it was a process of discovering that call and what it was that God wanted of me. I had attended mission camps and things like that, which helped me in this process. But it was over the years, and then through college, after my 12th standard, I did feel a call, but I felt not yet. So then I continued, did my BSc at Xavier's College. And then by the end of my TY BSc, I was more sure that while there were different opportunities in life that were opening up, I felt that this was the place where God wanted me to be. And this was the place where I was going to find that fulfillment in my life. So that in short is how I maybe got aware of the call and was motivated to follow it, answer it.
Father, when you decided to join the priesthood, what was the reaction of your family? How did you convey it to them? What was their reply?
Yes, I had been feeling this for a while, and I'd expressed this to my mother after my 12th standard or so. But I'd also expressed at that time that I didn't really feel fully sure about it and would like to wait on. And mommy was comfortable about the idea of saying, just wait on, stay on. By the time I felt more clear, I felt that need to discover. I first spoke to a couple of priests. We had a number of Jesuit priests who had different groups, youth, and running the youth group and taking us for camps. And I felt close to a couple of them, and I had expressed this to them first in order to arrive at better clarity for myself. When I thought it was really going to be something that God was calling me to, and I was pretty confident about it, received confirmations about it, then I felt the time I spoke to my mother, I was hesitant. And in fact, one of the priests had told me, but what about mommy and how is she going to manage?
Yes.
And that was a thought uppermost in my mind. My elder brother had already joined the diocesan seminary a year before. But when I spoke to mommy and I did express this aspect of doubt, it wasn't a doubt coming from within, but it was from the external circumstances.
Right.
What about the family? And as the priest's friends had also mentioned that to me. I checked that out with mommy. Mommy's reply was, if God is calling you, I cannot stand in the way. Furthermore, if it is God's call and you answer it, God will take care of me.
Right.
She was clear about that, and that was amazing. That was amazing to see. It wasn't like, no, Baba, you must stay at home. You have to look after me. What will happen to me, etc. Nothing of that. If it's God's call and you're answering, I know that God will take care of me.
Okay.
So don't worry about what happens to me. There's a greater power looking after me. If that's your call, follow it. You will be happy, and I will be happy knowing that you are happy.
You're happy, yes.
So that was a wonderful
backing.
You know, it was
that
something
was really
amazing
wonderful.
To get that from mommy. Then I approached the priests who were the vocation promoters. They put me in touch with the proper authorities. Since I had been in touch with the Jesuits, it was kind of a natural thing. I felt attracted to join the Society of Jesus. I didn't know much more beyond Stanislaus and St. Xavier's and all, but that's once I joined the pre-novitiate. It was here itself in Vinyalia, which was the pre-novitiate, and then later I went to Nasik for my novitiate, and that's when I was fully initiated into the Jesuit way of life.
Father, during your formation, did you have any second thought about the vocation to it?
Well, I wouldn't say there was any clear second thought, but that there were challenges, yes, and there were some doubts.
Yes.
Doubts that arose on the one hand from my own sense of unworthiness. So there were those sort of doubts that am I really able to match up to these expectations, to be like these priests whom I admired, to follow the demands of this way of life. So there was questions that arose from there.
Right.
There was also one moment, which I must, without going into details, when I did feel, well, maybe this is not the way of life for me. Should I look at the married way of life? And that's because of whatever, while growing up, certain attractions, certain feelings that were there within me came to the fore at a particular time.
Right.
I soon enough, within that, I realized, I spoke to a couple of priests who did not insist that, no, you have to break away from that and look only here. They just asked me to be open to what God was saying. And I think that freedom helped me to rediscover my way and my commitment here.
Okay.
So they gave me that freedom. So while I would say, yes, there were no serious doubts or second thoughts, but yes, there were the constant sense of unworthiness. And once in a way, as I said, there was this moment of wondering whether I was called to another way of life.
Oh. And how were you able to overcome this kind of doubt?
Well, one is, I must say, our Jesuit formators have been wonderful.
Right.
They didn't force a particular way of thinking or particular procedures onto me, and I would say even on my other companions. There was that freedom which allowed us to discern. But they helped us to always say, get in touch with what God is doing within you. What we may call in Jesuit terms discernment,
yes.
Discernment of spirits. Learning to see what God is doing in the innermost beings of my heart. And so my formators helped me a lot in that. I would say also, I think if I'm able to overcome some of the doubts or some of the pressures, pulls from outside, I would attribute a good bit of it to the prayers of many people.
Right.
People who were praying for me, who were praying for what is best for me.
Right.
And I'm sure that their prayers had an effect on me. I would also attribute it to a growing union with Jesus. Each challenge, each doubt is a moment to go back and examine, who am I, what am I called to be?
Right.
And in that, every time I go back to it, there is that sense of saying, who is Jesus for me?
Yeah.
What does Jesus want of me? And I think that growing union with Jesus was a key factor in helping me to overcome doubts.
Yeah.
Not that we'll ever be fully free of doubts.
Yeah.
I think the doubts will remain, the challenges will remain. But I see in this, the prayers of people outside, the ability to get in and discern what God wants. And I think above all, that growing union with our Lord Jesus, these are factors that helped me and I'm sure will continue to help me meet challenges or doubts.
Right. 22 years as a priest, Father, were there any challenges that you have faced and how have you been able to overcome them?
Yes, in a way it continues from what I said about the challenges during formation, though here the challenges do come up in a bigger way because you're directly in contact with people all the time. And I would say the biggest challenge that I have faced comes from the very nature of the demands of the priesthood,
yes.
The very nature of priesthood itself. As a priest, I am for everybody, and there's a beauty and a joy in it. But there is also this fact that I do not have anyone also whom I call my own. And so while I may lead moments of great intense fulfillment in the ministry, there's also that loneliness, that going back to your room alone, the fact of knowing that you've touched the lives of many, but you still are finally by yourself. Now, I'm not saying this that it's a terrible tragedy or anything like that, but there are those moments when the loneliness comes through. That, I think, has been for me the biggest challenge. The challenge from home and the external circumstances by now had sorted themselves out. It was only my mother whom I was worried about, but she had really got herself fully and was financially okay, and she had got herself involved in church work and in working for a widow's movement. It was so fulfilling for her that she was fully satisfied, and that kept us, her sons, also very happy and satisfied because we knew that mommy was okay and being really well taken care of just by the Lord by showing her this ministry for herself. So I think that side was taken care of. It was more this, the demands, the nature of the priesthood. Another difficulty you face is sometimes that of being misunderstood.
Right.
And there are those moments when you may want to reach out and it's misunderstood. There's something you say and it's not taken maybe in the right spirit. There have been those moments. I wouldn't say that they've been done out of malice. It's just perhaps that wavelengths were not matched at a particular time when I have felt misunderstood at times in my priestly ministry. What helped me, I have to go back to the answer I'd given earlier, the ability to discern. This time, the prayers of so many people. But always, always going back to, I have no one but the Lord. And finally, it is in the Lord that I must find the answers. It is in the Lord that I must find the strength to meet the challenges and carry on that way of life. And that has enabled me to carry on and be happy as a priest these 22 years.
Okay.
And I'm sure with the Lord's help in the years ahead.
Father, apart from the challenges that you had, there may have been incidents which you cherished a lot, something that you really were happy about. Could you share some of these with us?
Sure, I'd love to, because I think that's where really the heart of the priesthood is. Moments when we are able to reach out and touch lives with God's grace. But before I go to the actual moments, I must just say something that the fruitfulness and fulfillment I feel in ministry come from my core spiritual experiences, which are, if I may summarize them quickly, would be on the one hand, and my core experience of being a precious child of God. I think that is at the core of my being. The fact that I am God's beloved son, he is pleased with me, his favor rests on me. That's my core experience, and I want to communicate that always. My other experience is that of being a pilgrim. No matter how beautiful things are, I know that I am journeying on my way back home to the Father. These two core experiences are what I always like to communicate in my ministry. Coming to some cherished moments, I call to mind here a mass that I had celebrated in Vietnam. This was in Vietnam, it was in Ho Chi Minh City, was known earlier as Saigon. The church is now functioning more or less openly there, but there is still some amount of pressure. What happened during that mass, I can't really put my finger onto it, but when the person there went to read, and the person was reading in Vietnamese, the first reading, I couldn't understand though I had the translation. I was touched beyond measure by the fact of all those people there at the Eucharist and myself celebrating the Eucharist for them. Why? I'd heard stories before that of people who were there at the congregation who had actually been in jail, jailed by the communist regime, who had remained faithful to that way of life. And here was I now celebrating the Eucharist and these people participating in it. For some strange reason, it touched me, moved me almost to tears. The fact that these people have given their lives for this faith. And now I am here sharing that faith with them. And they are participating joyfully, singing, praying in Vietnamese. Yes. I was doing the parts of the Mass in English, but they were in their language. And somehow there was a great joy. It was like such a wonderful praise of God coming there. It had nothing to do with me. It was just the fact that as a priest, I was enabling them to participate in that moment of joy. And it was a wonderful moment for me. Another, if I may recall, and as I said, part of my work took me around to several countries. And that was a great blessing. Another one was in Zimbabwe. And I remember giving a session over there. And I was talking about this, my core experiences, and talking to others about them, reaching their own experience of God as loving Father, to experience how each one was a child of God. It was largely to a group of lay people, but there were a couple of Jesuits there. At the end of that session, I remember a senior priest, Jesuit, coming up to me and saying, "Hey Luke, you know something? I wish you had been my novice master." It was amazing. It was like I was struck. The novice master, as you know, is somebody who trains you, initiates you into the way of life. And I asked him why, and he said, "This was a message I was waiting to hear all along." Obviously, that priest had heard beautiful message. But in some way, what I was sharing about my life, what I was encouraging others to do, which was all the people there, had touched this person in a very core, in the core of his being, where he realized his own preciousness before God. And I would hope to God that there are others who have experienced their own preciousness to God through my ministry or whatever. My ministry is not the focus at all, not at all. It's just an instrument which is helping others. And when I realized that there are these moments when people have got in touch with their core identity as children of God, those are the most fulfilling moments for me.
Father, we would like you to share with us your vision for the church.
The church is guided by God, and God has his shepherds guiding the church. But I think we need to dream that also, the vision. So thank you for that question. I would say, just starting off, while I would look at the whole world in general, would start off by looking at India and saying, I think here the church needs to continue being what a church is, leaven in the dough, here in India, particularly in our context. If we look at what the church is doing, it's fantastic work. And I think we should be proud of it. The church is really striving to bring the kingdom of God here. We are a small minority, less than 2%. But we look at areas of service, education, health, outreach, empowering of the poorest of the poor, and the church is right there. Where so many places where the marginalized, the poorest or the poor are crying out for help, where there's that cry of the poor, the church is right there answering that cry, and we can be proud of it. We live in a context where there are so many different religions, but we can be this beautiful witness to God's love being leaven in the dough. And I think that is something that the church is doing and should continue doing with a sense of pride and a sense of mission.
Yes.
Proud to be Christians in this multi-religious context, but being leaven in the dough, being salt of the earth and bringing that light of God's love, that message of God's love, making the kingdom a reality here in our country.
Yes.
Going further to the whole world, once again I would borrow from an image of the gospel, and I would think the church has to be this light to the world.
Right.
Light to the world in terms of, first of all, the light which is not its own light, but which reflects Christ, the true light. The church as light, a reflection of Christ's light, being that, being nourished by that light which is Christ, and then radiating that to the world. The church being light to the world in that sense, radiating that love, showing that message of God's love, but the energy for it, the light from it, coming from being based, rooted in Christ himself, and allowing that Christ's love to be the one which helps us to give light to the world.
Right.
The light also is something that shows the pathway, right? A light is that which shows. And I think the church has to continue being that, helping the men and women of today to find that pathway to God. In a world which is seeking many things, and yet at the core of it, finally seeking God without even knowing it, the church has to shine that light in the hearts of men and women of today in order to show them that pathway to God. I think that is what the church has been doing, but needs to do in a very focused and concentrated way, so that the men and women of today, the world of today, sees that pathway of God in the way in which the church throws light along that
pathway. What would be your message to youth who are discerning, you know, their vocations as priests in for priesthood?
Okay, my message to youth, and well, in a way to families also, would be, first, a vocation is for everyone. Everyone has a vocation, be it in the lay state of life, the marriage state of life, or as a religious, as priest, etc. So first we must realize that everyone has a vocation, and all states of life are a vocation. So the first thing would be for everyone to sincerely discern in silence, in prayer, in consultation with spiritual persons, with seniors, by looking at the events of the world, in events of one's life, to discern sincerely there, what is my vocation and how should I follow it. So as I said, the vocation is to all walks of life. However, I'd like to say a few words specifically about the religious and priestly vocation. And here's my appeal, and I would make to all young men and women today. Perhaps God is calling you to this way of life, the religious way of life, the priesthood. I invite you, my dear young people, to look on this as a very special mission which God has given, to see in that your own uniqueness in the eyes of the Lord. The Lord calling you to be his minister, to be his apostle in a very special way. Yes, there will be challenges, and perhaps many more challenges than what I have faced. I came up in a time when there was a sense of still that the priesthood is a worthwhile vocation to be pursued. I don't know how much that is so today, but that's all the more then why this challenge should be taken up. At a time when we don't have people answering the call in this specific manner, there's all the more the need to take up that challenge. There's all the more that need to say, yes, in difficult times, I am going to be the one. The Lord is saying, whom shall I send? Can you, young people of today, young girls, respond to be a religious sister? Young men, respond to be a priest? When the Lord says, here's the cry of the earth, the cry of the poor all around, the earth suffering, the poor suffering, my creation suffering and groaning, whom shall I send? Maybe the Lord is asking that question to many of you in your hearts, to be a religious, to be a priest. Can you answer saying, yes, Lord, here am I, send me? I ask you to spend time reflecting on it. Is the Lord calling you to that? And if so, to respond generously. I would also extend this invitation to family members, to parents. Dear parents, I would ask you to instill in your children this idea of the vocation to the priesthood. Obviously, the vocation comes from God. It does not come from you as parents. It does not come from me or from anyone else. It comes from God. But can you, parents, create the conditions in your home so that your children can hear that call of God? This is my appeal, which I would make to you as parents. And in a very general way, if I may say, the message to all those who are hearing this, what was a testimony of my life, and really a testimony of the great things God has done for me, I would just say, I would borrow the words of Pope Francis when saying, what is our message? The message would be to realize, in the words of his recent apostolic exhortation, to realize that Christ is alive. Christ is alive. That is the message. To realize it, to search relentlessly for the signs of Christ's presence in our life. It's around, but at times in ways that are not immediately obvious. We need to search relentlessly for these signs of Christ's presence in our life, to discover them and to help others to discover Christ's presence in the world around. So this then would be finally my overall message to all, to believe that Christ is alive, Christ is present with us, and to do all we can to discover that presence and pass it on to others.
Thank you, Father, for being with us on this episode. We would also like to thank our audience for supporting us in this episode and viewing us. And we look forward to being with us in our next episode. Till then, stay blessed and God bless you.